Hello and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar. To begin tonight's program, we start with 'Twas the Night Before Christmas with Hadija Griffith. We then proceed to Cinema One, a preview from the 29th Black International Cinema 2014, end of season three, director Soran Fahim from Kurdistan. We then proceed to Cinema 2, again a Black International Cinema 2014 preview, entitled Black and Cuba, Robin J. Hayes, the director, from the United States of America and Cuba. We then proceed to Cinema 3, special work, work in progress, The Finger and the Moon, number 3, director Lee Uber. State of Affairs, our conversation is with a lady who is a performance artist, video artist, site-specific projects, human geography. I refer to Liuba. I wish to inform you of the passing of Mr. Fred Benjamin, who was a very distinguished colleague, choreographer, and friend. Mr. Fred Benjamin. Godspeed, Fred, Brother Fred, and we thank you for everything you did for all of us. So in addition to staying cool, remember you are participating in what else but The Collegium.
Support. 'Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief, and I in my cap, had just settled down for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. When what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer. With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came. He whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, and now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. So up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard of his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work and filled all of the stockings, then turned with a jerk. And laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like a down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim as he drove out of sight, "Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
جندي نعم سيدي اجعلوا لهم هذه الدنيا جهنم واحرقوهم فيها.
نعم سيد.
مندي.
نعم سيد.
لا تصابت تؤجلوا إلى الغد. الهواء ممطر.
نعم سيد.
صباح الخير.
بريار مانا من أبو سارو. أوي دي كي شيء مني كاكا. أبو أكسي كي ترد نارباي. تو بخونا سلم بابا تحرق سلقا كيدك. كردي تلقي؟
نعم.
کوایا تکوش زور تر ببیسی تا وای که بدوید. سارو پیتی و تو با چه شلی ری؟ جلگاند بکاره.
Thank you. مصطفى، مصطفى.
يا الولد يا ابني دلو عدوك علي وساك
ایره مالی منه، مالی من لکردستانه، کردستان، نامه به دنگی هیچ عربی بیسم، نگشتی؟
الو، جیانت باش، خراب نیم، سرقالی نسونی چی رو ککم؟
شونی مصطفى دلنيا يا مين خطا
Yeah.
What comes to your mind when you hear Cuba, like, on the news, in conversation, stuff like that? Negative, positive, what?
Negative.
Why?
Cigars.
It's like a place that you don't want to go to travel to. Not a resolved issue, but a non-issue, right? Like, right now, that our country's not even focusing on it.
Fidel Castro. We don't like him.
Why?
Because he's a dictator. He's probably cruel.
People there aren't happy or see better opportunities elsewhere.
I don't really think about things that I don't know a lot about. I feel like I need to educate myself first before I decide how I feel.
They're communist and that's pretty much all I know about Cuba, basically.
I think about Fidel Castro. What about Fidel? He's been in power for a long time.
I know, I passed it on a cruise to Jamaica, and we pointed at it but couldn't get too close. So.
Okay.
Ours, we don't have no freedom in Cuba.
Cuba is a very revolutionary country, to my knowledge.
I think communism is a good thing.
97% of the population can read. Medical school is free.
By like everything we got, they probably don't have.
It's the only place that's safe for the black man. One of my veterans, Sister Asada Shakur, was on exile, is in Cuba right now.
I think they need to lift all the embargoes, just open it up. It's about time. It's been going on for too long.
Che Guevara was the one that was pro-people living and appreciating the beauty of Cuba.
The greatest resource to any nation is its people. It's the people that make 125th Street flourish. If you want to read further, you can read this paper here, The Final Call. It speaks about Cuba, the Good Samaritan.
When I think of Cuba, I think of a place that kicked out imperialists and made a country for the people, by the people. Even though it's not perfect, that country embodies what all nations should be trying to strive for, some type of equality, you know, education, medical coverage, you know, equality in housing, and so on and so forth. And of course, I think of Fidel Castro and Che Guevara and all of the other great men and women that contributed to that struggle.
As a black resistance reading group. The struggle to create the ultimate field trip.
They venture to black Cuba in search of their revolutionary selves.
This documentary is a mixtape of a community's historical memory. The travelers' intimate recollections.
It's very easy being here on this spot.
And the salvage footage they filmed from their journey from the Ivy League to a rebel state.
We are the narrators of this film.
What does it mean to you to be a black student at Yale University?
I find that question very difficult to answer.
Are you mad? I mean, you know, what
I'm
you
very,
doing?
Yeah, I'm very angry. I'm very angry and lonely.
I did feel like an outcast at Yale. On the one hand, I have the community of color that I was raised in, which is very working class. As I would walk around campus, I never at all identified as being part of Yale, even though I was in Yale's power and privilege.
I had a certain anxiety, I guess I would say, you know, being a person of color too, being black and mixed race and going to Yale, and also the class issues of not having been trained in elitist kind of Ivy institutions.
I found Yale to be a place that was really exciting intellectually.
but I felt sometimes that the institution is not for me as a person of color, as a person from a middle-class background, single-parent background. I mean, it's a place that is for the production of the elite. It's for the future CEOs and the future senators and presidents and Supreme Court justices.
You end up building up a lot of cash, and I saw where your board has amply rewarded you for that success.
I never saw myself in that vein, so in some senses I've felt alienated at times from the institution.
Welcome to the colored section. Welcome to the Negro League. Sign your name on a blacklist and know this, it's American history.
Yale University was founded in 1701. However, the first African American wasn't admitted until 1850. African Americans weren't admitted in groups until the 1960s. In spite of this long history of racial exclusion, Yale is consistently ranked as one of the top three universities in the nation, along with two of the other wealthiest schools in the country, Harvard and Princeton.
A lot of the people of color were coming from middle class households where they may have been like third or fourth generation college students. And even for the people that were first generation college students, there's really this idea of like economics as being the purpose of an education. I have an entire family or community to support when I get out of here.
I grew up in just sort of, I don't know, maybe a 10 block radius that included my school, my church, my family. My mom and my godmother worked very hard paying next month's tuition bill. And I just sort of constantly feel that disconnect here.
See what it is to be blackmailed.
I was one of two or three black grad students in residence in the history department. I was at a reception towards the end of the year, and I looked around the room, and I looked at the portraits on the walls, and I thought, I've got to get out of here. And it was just sort of this, and I still don't have the words for it, but at that moment it was so oppressive, the extent that there was nobody here or there then for me to talk to. And it wasn't that there wasn't anybody black for me to talk to. There was nobody there who was interested in what I was doing.
It's difficult to know, I think, in this day and age, how to be political and feel like you're, on the one hand, in solidarity with movements of resistance, but on the other hand, so clearly in a position that makes you at least tangentially complicit in a lot of stuff that's going on in the world.
Where are you staying?
I'm staying because, you know, it's almost, I feel a need, you know, to stay here and get that degree because I think that's very important. I'm also staying here, you know, because I like school. I like my work.
There's some people who would say that, that Yale simply doesn't prepare you to cope with black reality.
And
that you are actually becoming not educated, but miseducated or whitewashed.
I think I see that as rhetoric almost, you know, that
you can educate yourself on campus without going to class. I mean, you can hook up tutorials, do what you want to do. I mean, people here are not feeding you stuff. They're not feeding you knowledge. I think that's a general misconception that people hold to, you know. You do what you want to do. Place affords you that freedom.
My experience at Yale has been that if I hadn't been in the African American Studies department, perhaps I would have felt like an outcast. But I didn't, because the department very much became a home.
African American Studies is also known as Black Studies, Africana Studies, and African Diaspora Studies. It's an academic discipline that focuses on the history, culture, and politics of communities of African descent. Beginning with the Third World Strike at San Francisco State College in 1968, coalitions of students, teachers, and community members demanded the hiring of African-American professors and classes that reflected the experiences of people of color.
The education that third world people need is one that sees the dignity and the worth and the pride of the people from which they come, enable us to, in turn, go back to our communities, increase and develop the level of consciousness of our people and why they live in poverty and why racism is continuing. The mainstay of keeping third world people poor.
Now, African American Studies, no matter what it's called or where it's taught, is politically informed at its roots. As far as a research-driven, quote, traditional liberal arts kind of program, that's what Yale has in African American Studies. That trajectory is very different from, say, those programs that were started with students with shotguns in their hands, literally armed struggle. They have a legacy of a different kind of practice of African American Studies. Now, which is better? This is up to you to decide.
Thank you. Cose che hai detto sono stimolanti, nel senso che c'è bisogno sicuramente, ciascuno per la propria strada, di pensare di vivere una qualche dimensione di spiritualità. Quello che sto sperimentando adesso da laico, che mi sembra che a volte la religiosità, tutto questo parlare di religione, in realtà sta proprio soffocando la spiritualità.
Oggi sentivo proprio il bisogno di fare una cosa legata alla spiritualità. Anche in casa, sono stata tutto il giorno in casa da sola, avevo bisogno di silenzio. E ho riflettuto un po' sulla solitudine della persona, che alla fine non è che ti senti da solo, anche se sei solo, senti che fai parte di un qualcosa di più grande.
Mi chiamo Grazia, vivo a Genova da 25 anni circa, però sono torinese.
Ho amici e amiche marocchini, islamici in genere, latinoamericani. Sono molto contenta di vivere in una città dove ci sono queste presenze quotidianamente. Sono nel senso più profondo delle cose che faccio, sono ambientalista e pacifista. Stasera sono qui come pacifista perché credo che la pace sia un valore universale.
Grazie.
E niente, sono qui perché voglio condividere con altre persone comunque una sorta di energia che ognuno ha, e più che altro a livello anche telepatico, di sentire qualcosa nello stesso tempo dare in un ambiente così come Sant'Agostino. Non avevo dubbi, cioè neanche dall'inizio, però ancora di più molto emozionata. Comunque mi piace molto questa idea.
Il coraggio che lei mette in queste sue performance, e questa in particolare mi interessa moltissimo perché io sono sempre stata molto sensibile al dialogo di pace, quindi il dialogo interreligioso, il dialogo relazionale tra le persone. Non pratico nessuna religione in particolare, però mi interessa ogni forma di spiritualità, no? Perché è sempre una strada che uno sceglie per sé, è un percorso che si fa nella vita, ed importante è che questo percorso sia sempre, come dire, mosso dalla sincerità, dalla fede e dalla volontà proprio di pace, di relazione con l'altro.
Ho 47 anni di mare e ho spiritualità, ma due tipi. Spiritualità liquida. In these 47 years of sea, I have gone around the world many, many times. I have met wonderful people all over. It does not matter to me the religion, caste, creed, color of any person. For example, my wife's Italian, she's a Roman Catholic. I am not. My religion is Sikh. It's very close to Hindu religion.
Hello and welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program, where we're very pleased to be joined by our special guest, Liuba. Liuba, welcome to the Collegium.
Thank you very much, and thank you to inviting me here.
What brings you to our fair city, Berlin?
Oh, well, actually, first, I like and I love this city. I've been there several times.
Okay.
But this time I wanted to move in Europe. I, as an artist, a visual artist, and being Italian, I've been traveling very much to express and to have the possibility to work more than in my country. And also, I like very much to interact with other people and to see other contests. So I was going back and forth United States for quite many years in the last 6-7 years. And now I decide I want to stay in Europe, and first I want to stay in Berlin.
What is your background in Italy? Did you study theater, dance, singing, or how did you lay the groundwork for what you're doing when you were still in Italy?
Well, my background is I always I grew up drawing and writing, and then I've been studying semiotic of art. I was trained at university. Yeah. I decided I was I studied also Fine Art Academy, and but I was focused on university studies as well, because I wanted to get a preparation from of the concept being an artist. I wanted to be to make something creative, because I was trying to express everything every time, drawing, writing, singing at that time. So I wanted to, so I follow this this river, and I studied the history of art and semiotic of art.
When you were studying, did you have any idea that you would take the direction that you're currently involved with, or how did this come about that you started doing what you're doing?
Actually, is a very interesting question, because it's a really work in progress. Mm-hmm. And also in my work and in my activity, I'm always experimenting and always changing, mm-hmm. and always seeing how society and the scene is going. Mm-hmm. So I began paintings, and then writing poems, and then I wanted to mix the two of them. Because at that time, people told me, oh, would you like to be a painter, or would you like to be a writer? You have to choose. You must be only one or the other. Okay, say, okay, should I cut up? This is so important to me. They are all important. Should I cut my legs, my arm? What should I do? And so then I decided, okay, I will join. I will mix them. Uh-huh. And so I began to work on visual poetry and mix visual and text. I was writing fairy tales at that time, and I was making drawings and the text. And all these disciplines melted together in this action that is a performance art. And I began to make performances exactly to mix different media. So the writings I was doing, and the images, and then I collaborated with musicians, and I began to really like this live action. And so I kept going on this multimedia direction. Yeah. Then I decided that it was enough to make performances for our audience just to be seen. And I began to go into the cities. I wanted to look society, to look into people, human geography. And so I began to work and to make my projects inside the cities, or inside a surprise situation. Mm-hmm. And for doing that, I needed to work on the videos. I began to work on the videos, because these actions were recorded mm-hmm. by several, one, two, or different cameramen. Mm-hmm. And then I end up learning video editing, because I have to put up together what it was happening to work on the final work. Ah. And it's still always changing.
I've had the opportunity to visit Italy, Siena, Firenze, Arezzo, places like that. The landscape, the architecture, the culture is very beautiful and very stimulating. How did that, being growing up in that environment, affect your artistic directions? What did you absorb from that helps you or stays with you until today?
Well, actually, I really love the aesthetic DNA, I can say, that I perceived that is growing up in my country, that is visible in the countryside, on the taste of the people, the taste of the things. So this is very influenced me very much. I can say that Italy, it's sometimes too much focused on the past. As for history, for example, is focused on Renaissance. Okay, is important, but it's beginning in a sort of way now to be focused on the contemporary art. I can say this that the contemporary culture, and for many years, it's like the country wanted to live to. Was remembering the glory of the past, and so every effort was going in the past. Also because we have tons of masterpieces for the past, and tons of museums. So all the also the economical efforts were going in the direction to preserve all the past, but not so much for the present and for the future. That is slowly happening now, but just starting, with some. Interested, but it has to grow up, the contemporary situation.
That's interesting. How? Because that concern is one that many countries possess, that is, of holding on to their culture, their history. How do you suggest that be combined with the kinds of things that you're talking about, say, the new directions or the possible experimentation? Particularly, it could be with mature artists, or it could be with young people coming along. How do you think that's going to be? How's that going to be worked out to combine both?
Having had my experience either in Italy and outside of Italy, I see that it's important that the context helps young people or also older people. To create and to dare to build up their dreams, and we are passing through a time in Italy that is not simple to cultivate dreams, and this is not so it's not so simple for the people. So I think that to develop all this, we need to that people begins to believe in culture and in arts, and in that can be a really social way of changing.
Well, you've traveled, you grew up in Italy, and you spoke about your travels to the United States, and now you're here in Berlin. What have each one of those, the other two, and you've traveled other places too, what did they offer you? What did you gather from them? What did you absorb from those cultures and those experiences?
I love traveling. I love traveling, especially because I love this sense of feeling at home in every place and welcoming every other simulation of all different cultures. So what I think it's more important to me, but maybe in general, of the traveling and to be in different places is to open your mind to others people, cultures, others people, being others people, tradition, but to see that at the most important things are the same for everybody. So I feel really at home. I was feeling at home in New York. I've been living in Brazil for a while when I was 20, and I loved Brazil. I was thinking, I'm born there. I'm born here. Yeah. And when I'm in New York, wow, I love New York. I love now I love Berlin. Sometimes it's quite difficult because you don't know where you want to stay. Right. But I really love this sense of universality, that we are all the same human being, the same problem, the same joys, the same love, and there are some differences. But I like to really much to perceive the unity among differences.
And with this understanding that you have of the shared needs and loves of people in various parts of the world. How do you, as an artist, as a creative person, how do you share that information with the general public or with other people so that they begin to see that they can compare themselves with the kinds of descriptions that you just made, the kinds of experiences?
Yeah, it's exactly one of the direction that I'm going to with my work is like to talk about people.
Yes.
I mean, when I was talking to you about the projects inside cities, mm-hmm. I was performing something unusual with some symbolical sign, but then my videos focus very much on the people that react to the performance, mm-hmm. and so the same performance performed in different countries mm-hmm. leads to different reactions and mm-hmm. different portraits mm-hmm. of cities, of people. And more recently, I'm even more involving people performing with me, as this a short piece we already mm-hmm. We saw of The Finger mm-hmm. and the Moon number 3, or the project I'm making in Berlin, in the sense to work with the people, with the humanity, go to meet the people, mm. go to listen to the problem, mm. listen to their stories, and then lead them to a project together, mm-hmm. to perform together. That it's the point of the iceberg, the mm-hmm. performance, the process of meeting and to get the people be comfortable and to make it. To make a symbolical action, I think it's very important in this moment mm-hmm. in my part of the world. But all my videos are talking about, and my projects are talking about people in a symbolical way as well.
Well, you just worked on a project with people that have come from other countries and are seeking to establish themselves in Italy and in Germany and many countries in Europe and elsewhere. How do you find the way with your work to communicate with the general population, the general public, that these people who want to be a part of European or North American societies, how do you communicate to the people that these newcomers are going to contribute something worthwhile to the society or have the potential to contribute something very worthwhile?
My contribution at this issue that I think it's very touching and it's very important, it's first to go to meet people, to meet the people and to listen to the stories. And the second point is to give a symbolical space, a performative space, mm-hmm. Creating an action together with normal public mm-hmm. to feel the unity and the uguaglianza, mm-hmm. if I can say mm-hmm. in English, of the people, and mm-hmm. so to focus on the equal rights mm-hmm. that everybody in this world has, and to focus on the equal dignity and the equal life we are trying to live. Everybody. So the idea is like to give voice, bringing these people together in a public space and performing silently together to be a signal of unity and acceptance.
We've just had the pleasure and the opportunity of viewing a work in progress by yourself. Where did the idea, or is that the basis for the idea of making that film? And how did you persuade the people to be a part of it?
Yeah, that's a very long process. And I was dreaming of having people of different belongings, different religions, joined together and meditating ensemble in a different way. Mm-hmm. This project is a work in progress also because as different previous steps mm-hmm. that was I was performing on Vatican on the Vatican San Pietro ground, dressed like a sort of nun praying in different prayers of different religions. Then some afterwards police came. It was But it was a very symbolical thing, and it was working. But that was my performance. And in this case, I wanted to invite people to be themselves, but to demonstrate that every street, every finger pointing to the moon has the same dignity if the important is the moon. And so it was a long work in progress in Genova to go contact the communities and to go to talk with people. A lot of people, oh, what a great idea. Yes, yes, it's a great idea. But should I come to pray with the others? Okay, well, I don't know if I can do that. Right. Or, oh, yes, a great idea. I will come absolutely. And then nothing happens. And these people that they arrived, that you could see in the videos, they are not actually. They are just every normal people that they say, okay, we want to be together, we want to give a signal, and so we want to participate with you. And so to have 12 people of different backgrounds was a really great success, and it was very touching because we have public and we were performing together. And at the end, it's a point of a symbol, not a symbol, but also a reality, because mm-hmm. this has been done.
That's interesting. Because you mentioned, I think, the Vatican, and when you talk about this kind of direction, isn't there a new pope who also has similar directions in terms of what he's bringing to the world, and also he's influenced many people to be very responsive to the kind of ideas that he has in mind, and also yourself. Where is the relationship between what you're doing and what he's espousing and what he wants for the world?
Oh, I think this Pope is very open. It's very open, and it's opening. When I was performing in Vatican ground, it was in 2009. Mm-hmm. So the Pope was
Pope Francis, yeah.
Yeah, but my work was not a question of Pope or I went to the Vatican ground because it was like a signal of a very important mediatic place for religions. And then I wanted that in this place, someone that was looking like a nun, but was not a nun, because the dress was built with a stylist with little details of all religions, so this sort of nun was praying in all different prayers, so was allowed to do that. So it was the language of art is like not explicatory. Mm-hmm. It's just a metaphor, a visual metaphor. Mm-hmm. So you see the nun praying like the yoga tree of life, mm-hmm. or to pray like a Muslim. Mm-hmm. It was very striking for the people, so a lot of reaction, a lot of people emotion, and it was really a symbolical and effective. And then police came and asked me what I was doing. Say, I'm praying. I say, well, yeah, it's not the right way to pray. And so that was quite a funny story. Right. and then they asked me, they say, okay, you can pray the way, every way you want, but you just please go behind the colonnade. That is Italy, it's not the Vatican.
Ah, okay.
And that was also a sort of mirror of a sort of situation.
What are your plans for the future, both in Berlin and I guess you're traveling to Italy? What's next for you, Liub?
Well, I'm now wish to finish this Finger and the Moon number 3 video, because my way of working is to have the idea, create the performance, and then create the video. So it's quite a long process. Mm-hmm. Or video that then it's going on installation and so. And I'm focused on keep going on this refugee welcoming project. Mm-hmm. I have been listening to stories. I've been in contact with some people. I would like to give my modest contribution in sharing some stories. So I'm gonna to build a video and I think a sound installation. I've got some recording of sound recording of some stories. Mm-hmm. And concerning this issue, for example, in Italy, we don't know the media, the country and the media don't say what is going on in Berlin concerning this fighting, this camp and the refugee. We know that there are desperate people arriving in Lampedusa and with this bad travel and with this a lot of people in the boat, so everybody's trying to help and but then so people Italy is welcoming, but then it's we don't know, the media stops saying. Then a lot of people I was talking about with in Berlin, they told me they were have been very welcomed in Italy, and then they have been working for a while, and then when the work was finished, also in Italy is a bad time. Nobody has a job. Mm-hmm. Actually, a lot of people is losing their job, so they moved here. But we don't know. The Italian media don't focus on what is going on. So I would like to give some information in an artistic way about this people that their right and the right to stay and to stay in this in Europe or wherever they want to stay, to escape wars in their countries.
Well, Ayuba, thank you very much for sharing your creative aspirations and accomplishments with us here on the Collegium. And we look forward to speaking with you in the future.
Thank you very much for your invitation. It was a pleasure to be here.
So stay with us. And remember, you are participating in what else but the Collegium.